And Sebastian, as we move into this, I think there's no better or more obvious place to start than with the topic of research. And your books are famous in a way for the vividness of the detail, the period detail, and the historical vividness. So love to hear you talk a little bit about research, how you go about it, how much time you give to it, all of that.
Yes, well, thank you for that very kind invitation and introduction. Something beginning with I, anyway. And I should just say that I first met Martin many years ago when I had written Birdsong, which was my fourth novel, and it was in proof at the time. And we all thought we were onto something, but it's very hard to convince the public that you're onto anything at all. And my then publicist, a very nice woman called Liz Sitch, rang me up and said that there's a chap who works for Smiths called Martin Lee who's read this book, and he thinks it's very good. And so we're going to go and have lunch with him somewhere in Wiltshire. And so we did. And Martin's name was on the very first proof copy of Birdsong. If you can find it, you can buy it for a ludicrous amount of money somewhere online. You'll see Martin's name there. And it was great, actually, because it was much better having someone inside the business than some reviewer no one had heard of who was probably sleeping with your ex-wife or something. And, you know, it had a sort of the authority of objectivity. Research. The American writer E.L. Doctorow was asked about this and how much research do you do, and he said, less than you'd think. And I think there is a temptation. Well, of course, the essential point about research is it depends if you're doing something factual, if you're doing something novelistic, something fictional. And after Birdsong, I wrote a book called The Fatal Englishman, which was three short biographies, three lives of people who had been like meteors, full of promise and brilliance, but all died young, around 28, 29, 30 years old, from different parts of the 20th century. And so when writing that book, I just wanted to find out everything I possibly could about all those three people, and that meant reading anything they'd written, letters, diaries, so on, published books. In one case, one of them had published a book. Talking to friends, people who'd known them, reading other accounts of them, I won't go on. It's obvious what reading everything or finding out everything you possibly can consists of. And in one case, the third in that of that three-part biography, a man called Jeremy Wolfenden. This was difficult to find out about because Wolfenden had been an academic, really, a very brilliant scholar at Oxford and All Souls. And then he decided he'd throw all that in and become a newspaper man. And he went off to Russia to work for the Daily Telegraph as their correspondent there. And while he was in Russia, something happened to him, something bad. And we're talking about now about 1960, the height of the Cold War, 59, 60, 61. He was set up in a honey trap with a young man by the KGB, Jeremy being gay. And they took photographs and they blackmailed him to work for them. And he had to report back to his KGB handler, basically kind of small stuff about what his colleagues were doing. Much of the Cold War was like that. He was simply trying to entrap more people, embarrass and compromise more people. But it also happened that he was involved with, because he knew the local MI6 guy who was on the staff of the British Embassy, a man called Rory Chisholm. And it so happened that while Jeremy was there, the West got its only ever spying coup out of Russia, which was a guy called Penkovsky, who was a colonel in Soviet military intelligence. And they carried out, they couldn't use Rory Chisholm, who was our standard spy in situ, because the Russians knew who all our spies were, thanks to Philby and Burgess and MacLean. So they had to use an electrical goods salesman called Greville Wynne, who used to take his caravan off to Bucharest and Budapest to trade fairs. There were all these trade fairs with the Eastern Bloc, which existed principally for the purpose of passing spying secrets, it seems to me. But he was ostensibly selling vacuum cleaners. But they needed someone who was more obviously in Moscow. So they couldn't use Rory Chisholm, the SIS man there. So they said, why don't we use Mrs. Chisholm? Because no one will suspect a lady. Janet Chisholm was a young mother with two or three small children. And she was entrusted with this absolutely hair-raising, I mean, appalling job of wheeling a pram into the park with her baby in it and two toddlers alongside. And underneath the mattress in the pram, there would be, and it sounds ridiculous, but there were micro dots, films, right, of Russian missile emplacements. And she had to hand them over, and or receive them, rather, for whichever it was, I forget now. This was an extraordinary thing to do, but when I came to write the story of Jeremy Wolfenden, all this had been sort of lost in murk, and people just said to me, Jeremy was murdered by the CIA in Washington because he got involved in this, that, and the other, and all this was incredibly difficult to unpick. But at some point, he married in Moscow the Chisholm's nanny, which is a quite strange thing for a gay man to do. She was an uneducated Irish nanny.
Right.
So he was a fellow of all souls and gay. Why would you marry him up? Anyway, it was a fascinating story, as you can imagine. But amazingly, somehow, I managed to find the wife who was living near Cork in a very run-down council estate. And there was just this sensational moment of meeting her, because I'd been given so many accounts of her, what she was like, all Jeremy's grand friends in their 60s, who were all rather toffee-nosed academics and intellectuals, say she was not one of us at all. She had a very odd voice, and she was, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And actually to meet this woman, finally, it was like meeting a character out of fiction. And she was absolutely charming. I mean, rather good-looking, very down-to-earth, very nice. And without any introduction, she started playing on her television a cine film that she'd had transferred onto VHS that morning. And it was a cine film of her and Jeremy's wedding in Washington in 1961 and 2. And in the background, I could make out younger versions of the people I'd been talking to, like Neil Asherson and Godfrey Hodgson and other quite famous journalists and so on, Philip French and so on. And this was just amazing and very, very exciting. And through her, I got copies of his death certificate, which he'd kept. And I was able to photocopy them, take them away. And with these, I was able to prove how he had died, which he basically died of liver failure because he was an alcoholic. He hadn't been murdered, though she talked me through finding him dead in the bathroom. And there were lots of dead ends that didn't quite add up. You know, was he wearing clothes? She couldn't remember. Why had he locked himself in and so forth? But I did feel that I'd got to the end of it. I'd established what had happened to him. And then I tried to get, I appealed to the FBI and the CIA for all their files, but of course, under the Freedom of Information Act, they're supposed to give them to you, but they didn't. They sent copies with everything blacked out. It just said, Jeremy Wolfenden met agent, black, then the whole, just sheets of black paper. So I appealed, but I didn't get anywhere. But so that's how, that was research in a sort of journalistic sense. Mm. With fiction, what you're trying to do is not give the complete story, because that would be a history, but what you're trying to give is an authentic feeling of what it was like. So, for instance, when writing Birdsong, I wanted to try and feel what the First World War was like for a soldier in the trench, and that's pretty difficult to do. I was lucky enough to go on a trip to the Western Front with some old guys. We're talking about 1988 now, when there were still people alive who'd fought there. People, but they were by definition quite well into their 90s. And they weren't really very good at giving you a sort of what did it feel like kind of answer, because they didn't really understand the question. What they would do is just give you anecdotes and so on. And after lunch, the anecdotes became extremely unreliable, frankly. But what was good about that for me was that I felt it was a very presumptuous thing to do to say, here am I, a young man who wasn't alive at the time these things took place. I'm now going to inhabit the body and mind of someone who was there and make it convincing for you, the reader. Mm. You know, it's a big, very presumptuous thing to do. But being with these men who'd actually been there, and one of them, I remember standing, holding my hand in the mud and saying, that's where the Germans were over here, this is where I stood when my best friend was blown up, and I buried little bits of him in a bag. No bit was bigger than a leg of mutton, and I stuck them in the bag, and I marked it with a cross over there. Mm. And I felt that I'd somehow connected, almost physically connected, through his hand, his feet in the mud, and so on, and the dismembered body of his dead friend. But what you're looking for, really, is little clinching details.
Right.
And I spent a huge amount of time in the Imperial War Museum, which has this fantastic archive of letters, papers, and so on, which were sent to them when they started in the 1920s by the families of soldiers, sailors, airmen, and so on. And a lot of it is very trivial, but trivial is good if you're, because you want to know, you want to know things like what they wore, what, how often did they get to shave, wash, change their socks, shower, go, you know, were they in the front line trench all the time? You know, what was the rotation? How long, you know, quite trivial things like this, which a historian isn't really going to tell you, because the historian is going to be talking about Austria-Hungary and Serbia and the maneuverings of the chiefs of staff. So, and then the, I remember reading letters, partly you just want to get the idiom of the time, hope, trusting to the very best of luck, thumbs up, merry and bright, you know, or these sort of little phrases. There, most of the letters home from the soldiers are very, very concerned that people at home shouldn't worry about them. This mostly is very touching. They're, they never complain about what they're doing. They're always reassuring people at home. And of course, you don't know that until you've read these things. But I remember reading one letter which just went into great detail about the different brands of cigarette available. I don't like Rough Riders, I prefer Glory Boys. And, you know, that's so these little details then, that's your, you really fasten on that.
It, it sounds like what you're really trying to do is to almost inhabit that that period, just to kind of let it fill you up almost, so that you can feel it.
That's right. I mean, when I wrote Birdsong pretty quickly, really. I mean, I'd been researching it off and on, thinking about it, reading books for 2 or 3 years. But the actual writing of it I did in 6 months. And I would write furiously in the morning, and then I'd go to the Imperial War Museum in the afternoon, and then I'd just immerse myself in this rather gloomy reading room in these piles and piles of documents, which it wasn't computerized then, so you had to fill in a card from a card index, these great long, you know, card index drawers and so on. And then I'd go home, I'd talk to my wife about it, and then I'd dream about it. And then I woke up and started writing about it, so I was completely immersed in that world.
How do you know when to, I mean, if you find it gripping, how do you know when to stop?
There is definitely a temptation for authors who become to overshare. They become so immersed in their subject and so fascinated by it, they want to take the reader by the lapel and say, and another thing you didn't know, here's another thing. And you really have to be strict with yourself there. I mean, one thing, one practical thing a lot of people do is they do all the research, and then when they come to write the book, they shut the research, they lock it away in another room, and they just won't go there at all. If it's stuck in their mind, if they've remembered it, fine. If not, not. Yeah. Of course, you then have to check when you finish. But I mean, I think that's quite a good self-discipline. Or you simply rely on your editor, your friends, your wife, your first reader, your, you know, someone you trust, to say, well, you know, this is great, really interesting, but you've lost me there. And do we really need to know all this detail? And you know, you just have to be strict with yourself.
And that, I mean, that's about the role of self-editing as well. Yeah. I mean, it's true of, you know, the day job of people in this room, which is you amass more data than you can ever really talk about and tell. And you must be in the same sort of situation.
Yes, but, you know, nothing is lost. You've still got the notebooks, you've still got the knowledge, you've still got the draft that you trim down, and you know, you can use it another time, or maybe it just goes into the back of your head and it's sort of compost there, that out of which a different plant or shrub will grow. But of course, the other essential difference between researching for factual biography and journalism and fiction is that in fiction you're not really trying to put across truth, you're trying to put across the illusion of truth. That may sound a bit fancy, but I can give you an example which I think shows it quite clearly. When I wrote a book called On Green Dolphin Street, which is set in the USA, it's at the time of the Nixon-Kennedy election, it's 1959, 1960, 61, that period. It was just when the internet was starting up and it was beginning to get easier to find things out. But in this country, we didn't have broadband. I didn't have a very good computer, and I actually hired a researcher who lived in America who worked in an office and where they had very good computers to do some research and some fact-checking for me. And at one stage, the main characters in the book leave Washington, they go into Maryland, they go over a toll bridge. And I said, can you find out what the toll would have been on this bridge in March 1960. And she said, fine. And she went to the Port of Maryland, Maritime Authority, whatever it was, and she emailed back, and she said it was $1.50. So I said, fine. And I put it in, and I thought, this is just the kind of clinching detail that people will like. And so there's a bit, Mary, I think it is, fumbles in her handbag for the correct change, and Charlie says, it's $1.50, love. And she said, no, so it's all in there. And anyway, the Americans came back and said, no way was it $1.50. That's way too much. And I said, but, you know, that's what the website says. You know, are you questioning your local government? They said, yeah, but, you know, make it 25 cents. I said, but that's not what it costs. Anyways, you have this to and fro. But in the end, of course, they're right. The reader reading that, they jar their toe on it. Mm. And I don't want the reader really to be thinking, gosh, how much was a toll over a bridge? I want them to be thinking, is Mary going to sleep with Frank? So I changed it. So there were two or three things in that book which I changed deliberately to falsify.
So the thing that's interesting about that is what of your research is actually in the service of the story, and that must be a decision you're constantly having to make.
Yeah, it is. And I mean, you mentioned at the beginning how much that my books have sort of serious ideas in them, and that one of the hardest things I think about being a writer is to gauge how much people can bear.
Right.
I describe it, there's a bit in the book I've just written where the guy goes off to write a book of his own about medicine, and he's never written a book before, and he said, I had no idea until I sat down how much of the job of an author is as a sort of agent or as a broker of the bearable, sort of deciding just how much people can take and how much they won't. Mm. And that you have that with this whole question of research, kind of fairly specialized things. It might be about genetics or biology or psychiatry or paleontology or various other things that I've written about, or, you know, army life, you know. But it's also, and I think there's probably is something a lot of people in this room will have some experience of, which is the question of how bleeding obvious do you have to be? Because, you know, part of the joy of either reading quite a subtle novel or watching a quite subtle piece of advertising is that you want to feel you're discovering stuff for yourself. It's not being rammed down your throat.
Yeah.
And it's such a joy when you just get one step ahead of the broadcaster or the ad, or in the case of reading a book, you think the author is really talking to you. But of the two people who I've just finished a book 2 weeks ago, and one reader said, you know, I really like it, but there are bits when you're slightly over-explaining, you know, hey, we've got your point, you know, pull out. And the other reader said, I had problems with these chapters because they didn't read like a diary to me. And they're not supposed to be a diary. So for one, I've over-explained, and the other one, I've under-explained. Right. So who do you listen to? And, you know, this is something that everyone in the communications business has to think about all the time, and it's a very fine job. But basically, if this very educated professional reader didn't get the fact that this wasn't supposed to be a diary entry, I personally think I failed there. Right. So I rewrote it, and he picks up his diary, and he says, ah, yes, and I closed my diary, put it away on the other side of the room, closed my eyes, and then I remembered. So no way can anyone now think it's a quotation from the diary. The diary's in the other bloody room. But sometimes you have to hammer it out. And, you know, it's only a line and a half of text. And I'm afraid my quick on the uptake friend will just think, oh, yeah, well, or whatever. But I've only bored him for a line and a half. Mm. But these are the decisions you're having to make all the time on every page, I think.
And is a lot of that conscious? I mean, that or have you got to that point in your writing career where some of it is almost second nature in terms of where you're taking the reader?
I mean, I write as though it's second nature, and I assume the reader is a clever person, and I've come halfway to meet him or her, and I assume he and she have come halfway to meet me. Mm. But that's why you rely on feedback. That's what you want from other people, to say, I didn't understand this bit, or you know, and so that's where you need that. Mm. But I think I'm very interested in I see it as a kind of triangle, which is, there's the subject matter is the apex of the triangle, what it's about, the war, Stephen and Isabel, or Charlotte Gray, or Frank and Mary, whoever it might be. Mm-hmm. And then there's you, are one corner of the triangle and the reader is the other corner. Most of the time, you here and the reader here are looking at the story. You're looking at the people in the book. And that's what the main dynamic is up to the apex there. But there is a way in which I think I am talking along the base of the triangle right. to the reader, really behind the back of the character.
Okay.
And I think there's the reader shouldn't really be aware that I'm doing that. But, for instance, in Birdsong, there's a rather awful scene in which Stephen, the main character, who is not the most likable man in the world, but he's interesting, I hope, but he has a very likable friend in the First World War, who's called Michael Weir, who's very innocent, naive, open-minded, open-hearted man, a certain type of young Englishman, I suppose. And at one point, out of politeness, Michael Weir stands up on the fire step to allow a ration party to go past, although he's an officer and he could tell them to bugger off. Because he's so well brought up, he stands up on the fire step, at which point a German sniper shoots him through the head and he dies. And this is an absolutely horrible thing to happen and doesn't often happen in serious novels, this sort of completely random, a bullet blew through you. But what I wanted people to think, apart from, you know, sorry for this poor man, was this author is completely ruthless. He's not really playing by the rules. He's just killed the nicest guy in the book with no warning. Bloody hell. And I, at that point, their sympathy is going up to the apex, to the character, and they're looking at me and, yeah, that's fine. I wanted that because at the end of the book, there's a very long protracted scene in which Stephen, the main character, is trapped underground. And the convention of adventure stories, at least, and also really of literary fiction, is that by and large your hero survives. You know, that's the whole drive of the book, is Stephen's insatiable curiosity to find out what the First World War means. What is this human creature that it can do these things, that killed 10 million of itself for no reason? What is it about us? He must survive. But all the time he's trapped underground, the odds against him surviving are very long. And I wanted the reader all the time to be thinking, well, normally we'd expect him to get out. But with this writer, I'm afraid, who knows?
Yeah.
And so there's a massive jacking up of the tension and the jeopardy there.
In that triangle, what's interesting there is that in terms of the telling of the tale, there's not just you, there's also the narrator. And you've also got, as an author, you've got a decision to make about what relationship you're going to have to the narrator. Are you going to take the first person, the third person? You know, and is that narrator going to be, in some sense, objective or unreliable? And that's also another kind of component to all of this, isn't it?
Yes. One of the keys to writing a successful novel is getting the voice of the narration. And people think that, therefore, that you only have a voice if it's being narrated in the first person. So if it's related by, you know, an ancient peasant lady woman, then it's going to use short words and funny old homemade expressions. And if it's narrated by a frightfully grand young Oxford Don, is going to have long sentences and a much bigger vocabulary and so on. But then there's also the tone. Are they a nice person? And are they ambitious? Are they proud? Are they condescending, etc., etc.? And that's true up to a point. But actually, even if you're writing in the third person, so it's he, she, not I, there's a tone, there's a voice that you need to find. And it's a question of sentence length. It's a question of what vocabulary you use, how many abstract words, and so on. And until you've settled into it, the reader isn't comfortable. The reader needs to feel, I understand now, I can hear this is the voice we're going with, even if it doesn't actually belong to one of the characters. And that's a sort of little-known fact, I think, about writing, that to finding that narrative voice is the key. If you go in the first person, the obvious thing you get is immediacy. People feel that you're confiding in them. It's one-to-one. So this triangle thing's not quite the same. It's much more like this. It's a straight line. The character is whispering in your ear, direct to you. So that's flattering to you as a reader. It's much more intimate. But at the same time, the drawback with that, of course, is that there can be no scene in the book in which the narrator is not present. And you don't know what any other character in the book is thinking or feeling unless they spell it out to the narrator. So you get a tightness of focus, but you get a loss of the wide picture. And, you know, you have to work around these constraints. And there are ways in which you can get around them, which are probably a bit technical and a bit boring to go into. But but they are this whole idea of an unreliable narrator is a bit of a cliche, really, because all narrators are unreliable because everyone tells a story from their own point of view. Mm. Everyone does. There is no such thing as sort of objective, omniscient, all-seeing, all-knowing, wholly reliable narrator. Maybe late Henry James. But, you know, the penalty you pay to get to that remote omniscience is sort of, you know, is hard work.
Yeah, bordering on unreadability for a modern audience. Okay. So that's a good point. And so, you know, and that's something that we all face, which is what position do we take in the telling of our tales? Do you make that decision early around whether it's going to be first person, third person, or does it make itself that decision?
It normally makes itself. I mean, the book I've just finished is first person. He's a bit of a roguish character, and I actually wrote the first chapter, which starts with him staying in New York on the Upper West Side in an apartment he's borrowed from a friend of his, and he telephones, he gets a call girl in, he has sex with her, and then he leaves New York in a hurry because he feels he's in disgrace. So it's quite sort of full on. It's not exactly coarse, but it's quite full on. And, you know, every time you write the word I, you know, there's a little tremor of self-consciousness comes over you. Right. I'm not quite sure about this. So for a long time, I just couldn't do first person at all, but I think I can do it now. As an exercise, I then changed it all just using the word processing change possibilities, and I changed I to he and me to him throughout to see what that would do. And there were a few little bit of tidying up, but only about 20 minutes. And it was very interesting what you got then. It wasn't fully third person. Mm. It was like a mixture of the two. It was a bit like Philip Roth, actually, where his characters are called Mickey Sabbath or whatever they might be called. But actually, they're sort of 80% Roth and only 20% someone else. So that was a pretty interesting thing to do. And I might try and do that sort of two and a half person, as it were, again, but basically by using a sort of word processing trick. Because basically, to hear that tone in your head would be incredibly difficult, I think. But in the end, I decided to go first person for the very simple reason that I don't really want to give the points of view of any of the other characters in the story. Therefore, the overwhelming advantage of the immediacy of the first person was irresistible in this case. Mm. But the first time I ever was able to use the first person was in a book called Engleby. But that book kind of used me as a sort of channel. I woke up one morning with this voice in my head. That sounds like the beginning of a very bad story, doesn't it? But I did. I think it happens quite often when people are either falling asleep or waking up. They hear music or they hear voices, not in any sort of schizophrenic or, you know, unpleasant way or morbid way. But as soon as you sort of wake up and try and jot it down, it goes. But this happened to me very clearly one morning as I was waking up. This voice started up in my head saying, "My name is Mike Engleby, and I'm in my second year at an ancient university." And I thought, hello. And,
hello, Mike.
Hello, right? And he kept on going. And I didn't make the mistake of getting up and trying to jot it down. I just lay there and let this voice go. And then I pressed a sort of hypothetical save button in my head. And when I got to work, I work in a little studio, some about 10 minutes walk from where we live, I was able to remember about half a page of it. And as I wrote it down, the voice, it sort of started up and it just kept on coming. Mm. And it just kept on coming. And I wrote this for about 3 weeks, and I thought, well, this isn't how I write books. This isn't how you do it. I start with, this book is about, this is the idea, this is the secondary idea, this is the tertiary idea, this is where it will be set, and these characters are these characters because they can exemplify these ideas in action. Now, start working. You know, I'm quite sort of military about it. But I can't just act as a channel for this weird guy. Anyway, I thought, well, I didn't have anything else on, but I thought, well, I'll give it till Christmas. I haven't got anything else on. And then, anyway, by Christmas, I'd finished. And about two-thirds of the way through the book, it became quite clear to me who this guy was and indeed what he'd done. Mm. It was something bad. Very, very bad. And I thought, well, I better go back to the beginning now and be fair with the reader and make sure that there are embedded hints and clues as to this. But when I went back, it was all in there. Mm. It was all there. I didn't need to change anything. So that was a weird experience. But it was a great book for me because it got me into the present day, and it showed me I could use the first person. And it connected with a lot of young readers who'd found my longer books. But the book before it, Human Traces, very sort of demanding, you know, long third person, very sort of Victorian kind of book. And Engleby is much more sort of modern. It's in a very colloquial way. And I found a lot of new readers there. And a lot of them, you know, think it's my best book. I mean, who knows? Not for me to say. But it was a great experience. And I feel very grateful to Mike Engleby for having having written it for me.
But he's not still in there, is he?
But sometimes, you know, there might be a volume two, Engleby Unbound, who knows?
he's already
terrifying thought.
He's already pretty unbound. You touched on the kind of the structure that you would typically bring to bear.
Yeah.
So, and you've hinted at that, but maybe you could tell us a bit more about sheer just plot and structure. Because, you know, I kind of referred at the beginning to your sort of storytelling flair, but that doesn't just come from nowhere. It comes from thinking it through and really working it out.
Well, you know, everyone has a different idea of what they like in books, and every writer has a different idea of what they want to do in books. But to me, I can't imagine being satisfied by a novel which wasn't about something. Which doesn't have a major theme and then subsidiary themes. And I don't know where this idea burned itself into my head from. Maybe just from the books that I enjoyed growing up, the books that made the biggest impression on me. They were all, you could say, well, what this book is really about is, and all the characters are variations on this. And I suppose also when I was first starting to learn how to write or think about writing, I listened to a lot of music. And classical symphonies are, you know, constructed in exactly this way, with one sort of major theme that plays out and then variations, and it's all wrapped up at the end, rather brought to a very triumphantly unified climax. And seemed to be that's the kind of novel I'm interested in. And one of the reasons I find a lot of modern fiction very disappointing is that they don't have any themes. They don't have any ideas. But, you know, obviously, if you get too hung up on that, you risk your characters becoming mere sort of ciphers or servants of this idea, and then they become boring. So your characters have got to be real men and women, old, young, you know, with lots of different ambitions and a whole sort of agenda of their own, and you've got to keep them working for you, but at the same time let them do their own thing up to a certain point. And there's a nice moment when you feel, I always feel it's a bit like saying we're going to drive from London to Venice, and I know we're going via Paris and Switzerland and Milan, but apart from that, you know, make your own mind up. And so if one of the characters says, I want a detour via Lyon, you think, well, okay, that'll work. We can do that. But, you know, if they say we want a detour via Caracas, then, you know, forget it.
Okay. So you have a broad structure mapped out before you actually start the writing.
Yeah.
But you allow a certain elasticity.
That ideally, yes. Of course, every book is different, but ideally that's what you want. And, you know, it is, I mean, in Human Traces, probably the favourite character I've ever created, who's a girl called Kitty. Because nowadays most writers don't really bother with giving characters a past or a family or a background or motivation. It's considered very old-fashioned. But in this book, she's the patient of a doctor in a sanatorium, and I gave her a complete Freudian case study over about 30 pages. And it amused me to do this because it was so sort of anti-fashionable, and it just was like two fingers up to... It was basically saying to these other guys, well, you can't really do this, can you? But I can. Then, well, this was all very well and, you know, amused me a lot and was very, very rude about Freud and his ridiculous early case histories and so on. But then the problem came when Kitty actually had to do something. And I had described this woman inside and out, you know, really very thoroughly, inside her head, inside her uterus, everything. And then the moment came when she'd then been operated on, and I described operations. The dear girl had to say something, and I was very nervous. And so the doctor knocked on her door, and I just didn't know what she was going to say. But thank God she just stood up from the bed, and she just gave voice, and she was absolutely fantastic. And whether, you know, maybe that was because I had so imagined her, I had so fully created her, but I'm not sure. She might have just been a mousy little thing who said nothing, and I don't know, but it worked. So then, you know, that's the moment you long for, when suddenly the character comes alive, takes over the story to some extent. Though she didn't get too far out of line, she stayed within the rough journey we were planning. But as far as stories are concerned, you know, the story, as far as I'm concerned, is the theme comes first, the ideas come first, the characters are people capable of enacting it, and then the story or the plot is what needs to happen for people to understand, you know, what you're on about. And I think that storytelling, essentially, I've learned a lot from films about this. Mm-hmm. I mean, films are very good for studying storytelling techniques and dialogue. It's amazing how few words are spoken in films. Yes. Boy, do they pay their way. Storytelling is really the secret of it, I think, is the timing of the release of the information.
Right.
You know something that nobody else knows. And it's just a question of the order in which you release the 10 key pieces of the information. If I said Roger Ackroyd was murdered by the narrator who left a spinning tape behind a locked door and then went back and then did this, and then the detective arrived and questioned all the things, that's a very poor way to tell a detective story. You don't want to know who Roger Ackroyd was murdered by in chapter one. You want to know that in chapter 14.
Yeah.
But really, once you've understood that about storytelling, you've got the 1 to 14 chronologically, but the way you release it to the reader is you put them all like the FA Cup draw in a thing, and the hot air blows them all around. You pick them up and you more or less randomly arrange them. Or then you don't quite randomly arrange them, because it's a bit more complicated than that to keep the reader on the edge of the seat. But story and plot is something that in serious novels was sort of fell completely out of favor, really following Henry James, actually, but who wrote novels in which nothing happens, and Proust. But actually, a lot happens in Proust, really. I mean, anyway, a lot. And it fell out of favor. But it so happens that quite a lot of serious, you know, literary writers can do story. And I think of it somehow as being rather the equivalent of artists who can do very good life drawings. If that's all you do, then you'll become a graphic artist, or you'll become, you know, there's a limit to what you can do. But it is a skill, and it's quite an important one, I think, to have at your disposal. And I know of one or two authors who I think are rather ashamed of it. It's like a sort of facility, you know, that they think, well, I don't want to be too good at plotting and storytelling and creating this little illusion, because, you know, I'll be like the guy who does your portrait outside St. Peter's and charges you 10 euros. So, and then, but it's, I don't think it's anything to be ashamed of. The point of, with storytelling, though, it must be always be in the service of bigger ideas. But if you have it, it's nothing to be ashamed of. And, you know, it's a talent you can work up as work on as well. Mm.
That's perfect, and I think there must be. I know that there'll be lots of people just on the subject of timing. Thank you. I need to be aware of that. I'm sure there's loads of people who would love to ask you some more questions as well. So, if we've got roving mics, or millions of hands going up already. So, gentlemen, just here.
I can shout out if you want.
Well, the sprinting mic coming in.
Often when people are trying to start writing, they're advised, write about what you know. Do you agree with that?
Write about what you know is certainly the advice that is so often given to people who want to start a career as a novelist or short story writer. And it is undoubtedly the worst piece of professional advice ever given. As I discovered over many long and barren years, write about what you don't know is the way to be a writer. And discovering that liberated me and enabled me to be one. But of course, as I was saying beforehand, there are no rules And, you know, that's what worked for me, and I think that would work for the majority of people. But what was the greatest novel of the 20th century? If you took a vote among literary critics, they would probably say In Search of Lost Time by Marcel Proust, which is almost entirely autobiographical. But he had the genius to transcend that limitation. But it's sort of, you know, don't try and follow Proust, he was a one-off. But you know, seriously, there are people today, there's a very talented writer called Edward St. Aubyn, who's written a series of books, which are again largely based on his own life, and somehow he's found that elusive tone of voice which enables him to do it. But I remember teaching on a creative writing course on the Arvon Foundation, and there are about 8 people in a sort of residential thing in Cornwall, maybe 10, and 8 out of 10, it was just their own life story. They were come to terms with problems in their lives and thought that writing fiction was a way of doing it, and they were all more or less terrible. And I gave them an exercise, which is you have to write in the person of someone of the opposite sex from you, not closer than 25 years to your age, from another country, and not living in this century. And what they came up with was sensationally good. I mean, they were obviously people who had some talent, but they were just, you know, churning through their own love life again was just no way to go.
Yes. Hello, I seem to have managed to grab the mic from Charlie. Thank you very much. That was absolutely fascinating. It's a long time since I did my English A-level, but I remember a great obsession with the first sentence of a novel. And I often find when I'm in presentation scenarios, getting that first sentence right does kind of set me off. How much do you think about the first sentence? Is that something you do write at the beginning? Or do you come back at the end and write a brilliant first sentence? Or does it not matter?
Well, at English A-level, I used to write the essay first, and then I'd write the first paragraph at the beginning, which explained what was coming afterwards, which I didn't know when I first read it. So that way, everything was incredibly relevant. I think that it goes back to what we were talking about, or I was talking about just now, which is finding the right tone of voice for the narration of any book. And it's this funny little secret. You've got to find it. And so, therefore, in all my books, the first chapter will have been written about 30 times, the second chapter only 5, the third 2, and the rest once or twice. It is endlessly, and the first paragraph more often than any other part of the book. I think you don't want necessarily to go for a too showy an opening, because that can alienate the reader. The reader doesn't want to get to the end of the first sentence and think, hello, this author's trying to grab my attention, or hello, this author's trying to show off, or hello, this author's a bit of a pillock. The reader wants to get to the end of the first sentence thinking, I'm really interested in reading what's in the second sentence. So I don't think you want to be too showy, but I completely agree with you that kicking off the right way. I mean, if you get off on the wrong foot, there's often no way back. Well, people just won't read past a certain amount.
Gentleman over there.
What is the balance between genius and hard work in creating books?
That's a very difficult question, to which I'm sure there is no hard and fast answer. But, you know, is genius an infinite capacity for taking pains, which means it's 99% hard work, 99% perspiration, 1% inspiration, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? I don't know. But, I mean, there are certainly people who, when you read their books, you can tell within 2 sentences that they can do it. And there are people who used to get a lot of stuff sent to me by people saying, please, would you read this and get it published for me? And it was all fine, and it was all perfectly well written in terms of, you know, grammar, and it was all laid out nicely on page, and it was all about quite interesting things, but it just didn't live. And how you teach somebody to make something live, or how people who can do it, I'm not quite sure. But I was driving down to down the M4 the other day, and on the radio I just turned on the radio, it was a fag end of Woman's Hour, and there was an American serial going on. There was just one little bit of dialogue in which a woman was saying, so how do you do it, you married women? How do you keep your husbands? What is it that keeps you going, blah, blah, blah? And I thought, ooh, this is interesting. This is witty. This is better than you'd get by chance. And it was Anne Tyler. And I hadn't read the book, but it was, it was something within four lines. You could tell that this person, this writer, whoever it was, I didn't know, had just got a slight angle on the world. And that's just a gift, but it's a gift that perhaps came from reading an enormous amount and thinking hard about what she had read and then working out how that could fit in with her own view of the world.
And so in your own case, Sebastian, do you find that there are some parts of the whole craft that come to you relatively easily and some bits that you've really had to work at to hone and perfect?
Yeah, I had to work on dialogue a lot. I didn't really understand what dialogue was for. I thought it was so I could give people a sense of what the characters sounded like. So they'd come and say, "Hi, have you? How did you get here? How was your journey?" "It was fine, thanks. Which way did you come?" "Well, I took the train, actually." "So, shall I have a drink now? What do you want?" "I'll have some cider." It's completely boring, you know. But in fact, dialogue in books, all books, is completely unrealistic. It doesn't have the ums and ahs, the loops and repetitions, but it's also it's unrealistic in other ways. And the function of dialogue in a book is to convey information by other means. It's as simple as that. And sometimes, and the best dialogue is the sparest. And I always think of Harold Pinter or Noel Coward and think of them reading my page of dialogue and scoring out lines. And eventually I get it down to about half the length. Okay. But you can only do that in third person. Mm. In first person, sometimes someone has to speak, otherwise you don't know what he or she thinks.
Right. I'll allow one more question, so we're already over in the question in the far corner.
Hi, Sebastian. You said earlier that you roadmap your novel going from London to Vienna and you let your characters take you on detours if necessary. Yeah. Have you ever ended up at a different destination?
No, I haven't, because I just don't think I would allow them to do that. But I did, with the book I've just finished, which is called, this is the first plug, this is the first public plug for my new book. It's called Where My Heart Used to Beat. I did, as I was nearing the end, when the main character re-meets a woman he'd been in love with 40 years before, I wasn't quite sure which way it was going to go. And there's a wonderful scene in The Age of Innocence by Edith Wharton when this man goes to Paris to meet the countess who has almost ruined his life and with whom he has been the love of his life. And his son takes him and they look up. He looks up into this beautiful house where she is living and he sees a shadow behind the curtain. And he turns and he walks away. And I didn't know with my re-meeting, he goes to a ski resort because she needs to be up in the air for various reasons. And as he stood outside, I wasn't sure if he was going to go up. And I'm not going to tell you if he does. You'll have to find out. But there, I think I've always ended up in Venice or Vienna, if that's what I was aiming for, but there's ways of ending in Venice. You can end face down in the canal. You can end in the Cipriani sipping a nice cocktail. And even if you get where you want it to go, there's a mood and an emotion, and there's another way of finishing the story which remains alive until the very last full stop.
Full stop's a good way to finish, always. In a moment, Jane's going to come up and close the conference, but I'm sure you'll join me in thanking Sebastian for a riveting presentation.